Okay, we hope it's not worse.
Come back and visit my friends in the States on the way back.
It's the cheapest. Acoustic phonetics in teaching English as foreign language.
Sorry for this little delay, but hopefully it should work now. This is the last talk before.
Excuse me.
Before lunch. Can't hear me, all right? If I come a bit closer, would it be better?
No.
Maybe I should use the microphone.
Yeah.
Yes, keep it soft. Keep it soft. Now it's on. Is it any better now?
That's better.
Yes? Yes? Okay. So I was saying that it's the last talk before lunch. So I'm not going to give a dense talk, but instead I'm going to set one of the most common problems we confront every day when we want to teach effectively and when we want to integrate acoustics, phonetics, and DFL teaching. But as you know, we find many, many, many resources on the internet, many softwares available, and we end up with a whole lot of material that we don't know how to use effectively in class. So what we want to do is to put forward a proposal which then integrates acoustic phonetics, some teaching tools and resources from the internet in the context of EFL teaching. Right? So in a minute I shall be telling you about the course objectives in relation to the session types. They're not lectures, theory lectures with theoretical information, but they are a mixture of both theory and practice. The course materials I shall be describing in a minute include links to web tutorials, links to other websites, software program. Then there are also practical exercises which I shall describe in a minute with filling the gaps, true false statements, multiple choice questions, and I shall spend a bit longer describing the spectrographic and F0 analysis performed in recorded speech files. So also, as part of the material for this course, we had to do some specific recordings which would focus on specific problems that Canadian Spanish speakers encounter when they try to speak English. Why does this keep moving?
I'm sorry, I have the mouse in my pocket.
Switch it off or bring it down. Okay, right. So, So all this then is built into a PowerPoint presentation. So the platform we're using is PowerPoint presentations, and of course this can be printed out as you can see from the handout, a student's handout. Right. So what are the course objectives? What do we intend to achieve with this, with all this material? Points 1 to 4. Have to do with the contents we give students, the content, how much knowledge should they achieve in acoustic phonetics. Well, we'd like them to achieve an intermediate level of acoustic phonetics. Sometimes it's not always possible to achieve that intermediate level, but that's the aim, okay? To identify and discriminate these substitutes of English vowels and consonants, to develop basic conceptual skills on intonation, and to promote cross-linguistic contrast awareness. We've been hearing different talks about the good thing is that students realize what's going on in either language, and then they can focus on that and work on it. Points 5 to 7 have to do with the methodological framework we propose. So we want to put forward an integrated approach, including acoustic phonetics, EFL pronunciation, and intonation. want to offer a methodological framework and to develop and implement a self-study approach by an effective use of internet resources so that students, once they finish the session, which the session in like the university in the department, when they go back home, if they can access the internet, they can play around with the resources we've shown in class. So they can carry on with their own self-study as well. By the way, the sessions take place in a computer room. Okay? So all these facilities have been either downloaded or stored previous to the course on the computers. Right, so now I'd like to show you how we present the topics about acoustic phonetics. So how do we go about telling them about phonetics? How about acoustic? Well, we do this always resorting to diagrams or illustrations, and PowerPoint allows us to do it dynamically. So when we talk about the source and the filter, I beg your pardon, when we talk about the oral tract as being like the source or the filter, well, we can do it in this way, where figures, not figures, but boxes and arrows appear as we go along describing whatever we've got to describe. How are web tutorials incorporated? Well, this one shows the case of aspiration, and there's an excellent web tutorial by John Maitland on the internet. And the way we do it is to set the problem, in this case it's aspiration, and then think about what's happening when you do it in your own language and you try to imitate it in English. And finally, we give them the answer. So, what are you doing? So now we can go to the web tutorial. This is how we motivate it. Now, I don't want to try it, but if we click on the green line, we should be able to access John's tutorial. But I haven't transferred it to this computer, so I won't try it. Okay, how do we introduce them to the spectrographic analysis? Well, this is just a descriptive stage. So,
take day.
This is one of the files that have been recorded previously, and we play the speech file, and then we go little by little, cue by cue, describing the differences between t and the in both words. Okay, so we're doing a very kind of step-by-step analytic analysis. That's redundant. Analytic study, I should say. Mm-hmm. And the burst and a few other acoustic cues. Okay, so it's gradually built up. Right, now another way to link or to motivate their own participation is by using this kind of prompts which trigger their thinking. In the handout we set transitions because we were thinking of moving from one transparency to the other, but in the end we thought it would be better to say, okay, this is a prompt. We're not going to move on to the next transparency, but we stay in this transparency. So again, in the description of the oral cavity as a source or a filter, we incorporated this kind of question. What happens if there's no vocal fold vibration? And, well, they have to think about it, and we might wait for some responses, and then we get the answer. Okay? And this is another way of prompting their thinking. Think about these words, say them aloud, and here they do some recording, and the software we are using is WASP, the SFS system by Mark Patrick, also in his department. Mm-hmm. So they record their own voices by using this piece of software. And another prompt we might use is this. They recall the wrong vowels, and then what would happen if you change your voice quality? Okay, what, in what way does the spectrogram change? Do you see darker or fainter? Okay, so just to remind you then, let's move on to the practical exercises, which are of these four types, and let's have a look at each one of them. So, fill in the gap exercises, they're pretty straightforward. Here, they've got to fill in the gap with one of these words. So, number one, a change in shape of the has an effect in the sound quality or the oral cavity. Okay, they would have to fill in the gap with oral cavity. True or false statements, just say whether these are true or false. The oral cavity shape affects sound quality, true or false. Multiple choice questions. Here we address, the example I show you here is addressing the specific difficulty that Spanish speakers encounter to distinguish between accent and intensity, a very common difficulty. So, X syllables are those associated with pitch movements. Here they would have to choose accented syllables. Okay, what about the spectrographic analysis? Inspired in the work by John Maitland and colleagues when they compiled the CD-ROM on the analytic listening exercises, which is available in this listening center, by the way. Inspired on their technique, we thought, why don't we do the same thing acoustically? Okay, so rather than analyzing the whole segment, let's analyze features or acoustic cues in this space and take them little by little. So these exercises, I would suggest, are graded. So in a beginner stage, what we do is get students to identify the limits of sounds, if they can. So for instance, here it's the beginning of the end of a vowel or consonant, or areas of greater or less amplitude, or what we call vibration. So it's not, it shouldn't be of great difficulty since we are at the beginner stage.
Aka.
Okay, and as you can see, it's not even, it's an English speaker, but it's just aka, a nonsense sentence.
Coat, goat.
All right. At a more intermediate level, we ask them to do this analytical listening, and then some recording. So here, they're working with coat, goat, and they've got to identify the acoustic difference between the two words, so they're comparing two words now, and reproduce them and record them. Okay, so one thing that allows us WASP to do is that when they record their own voice, we can show, we can have their own performance on one side of the screen, open WASP again, and have the model on the screen again, so that they get a very good visual input of what they're doing right and what they're doing wrong, and how they can improve it. Okay, so we can divide the screen into two sides, have the model, have the performance. Okay, compare it. Another type of little exercise at this intermediate level is to identify acoustic cues. Right? So we tell them, this is the speech file, we've got it stored on the computer. Look for the silence, the first bar, sonority bars. Where are they? Where do they begin? Where do they finish? Because we might be looking at whether there's any aspiration or not, whether there's any voice loss of time or not. At a more advanced stage, they carry on doing the recording, and we start with a contrastive detailed analysis. So here they will be working with things like ter, ver, log, and they will be doing, as I say, comparing what happens in ter, what happens in ver, and so on. And another type of exercise at this advanced stage is a cross-linguistic detailed analysis and further description. So here we are focusing on things things like wordy, worthy, where in English there is a contrast, limit contrast between the medial consonant, but in Spanish the tendency is to produce both consonants as fricatives. So here we guide them in their own analysis. So by asking these questions that you've got there to, from number two to number eight, we, as I say, we guide them and then take them to draw conclusions of their own findings. Mm-hmm. So with this talk, what I've tried to do is to find a balance between how much quantity and in what way acoustic phonetics can be complemented with EFL teaching, and whether we can find a balance for a balance in both information for our students.
Thank you, Mercedes. Now, questions?
It's very obvious that we do this to raise the awareness, etc., and I do this with my students. Do you know of any evidence that it really works?
The little piece of evidence we've got is an informal questionnaire we got from the students at the end. And they said that they haven't noticed, for instance, their intonation. They haven't noticed that they could copy some of their Canarian Spanish intonation onto English. Because what they did was to, when they did things in English, they would use standard Spanish type of intonation. So they would overdo it. And what they needed to do is to, hey, you've got it in your own accent, just adjust it for English. So it does draw some awareness, and the visual input is fundamental. It's not just audio exercises, but the visual input really works.
Yeah. More questions? Yes.
Yeah. Do students keep a portfolio or anything that allows them to see progress in time?
Well, there are two answers to this question. One is that since it's so interactive, I mean, not the students with the computers, but interactive with the lecturer to go around helping out the students, they get immediate feedback from the instructor or the lecturers, whoever are there. And then what we haven't designed for this course is an assessment method. We haven't designed it yet. But I guess that the exercises we could develop could be of a type of fill in the gap questions, or we could give them, they could go through an oral test where, okay, we give them a spectrogram, they've got to describe it or identify specific cues, acoustic cues.
One more question?
Michael, not a question, but I just wanted to say, if you have yet to present and you want to use your own laptop, please find one of us and we'll try it with a projector. The problems we've had this morning aren't really failures. I'm sure it's caused by differences in the graphics adapters in the laptops. Their ability to cope when they're connected to a display that has a different resolution from the native resolution of the laptop. That's what's going wrong. So with a bit of time, we can probably fix it, even if you want to use your own machine.
Thank you. Thank you very much.